Penguin Random House Audio presents Children of the Holocaust, Conversations with Sons and Daughters of Survivors by Helen Epstein. Read for you by Nan McNamara. In memory of my father and for my mother. Acknowledgements. This book would not have been written without the cooperation and enthusiasm of the children of survivors whose names appear in this book, those whose names are disguised, several hundred others with whom I spoke and corresponded, and many of our parents. I would particularly like to thank my late mother for her moral support, patience, and criticism. Introduction to the 2019 edition. The Polish literary journalist Ryszard Kapuściński wrote, "Each piece of reportage has many authors, and it is only thanks to long-established custom that we sign the text with a single name." That was particularly the case with Children of the Holocaust, a collective endeavor that at times resembled a virtual consciousness-raising group more than a series of interviews between reporter and source. The result was the first book to explore the psychological aftereffects of genocide in a group that came to be called the second generation. For me and my interlocutors, the experience was extraordinarily powerful. By articulating our private concerns out loud, Children of the Holocaust changed our lives, and hundreds of readers have let me know the lives of many others. Some read it cover to cover on the day they bought it. Others put it in a special place and were afraid to open it for years. Still others carried it in a bag to be shared only with trusted colleagues and friends. One of the peculiar features of trauma is that shame perversely attaches to the victim rather than to the perpetrator. An aura of taboo and shame surrounded many families of Nazi victims, particularly in Europe. While a few groups in America, such as the Warsaw Ghetto Resistance Organization, publicly commemorated Jewish heroism, as well as martyrdom, and created youth groups for their children, most discussion of the Holocaust was not celebratory. Some survivors had the Auschwitz tattoos on their forearms removed. Many changed their names and religious affiliation in their new countries. All, except the irrevocably damaged, focused on the enormous task of rebuilding their lives, the majority in new cultures. Whether they continue to live in Eastern or Western Europe, under totalitarian or democratic governments, or immigrated to North or South America, Australia, or New Zealand, they wished to forget the horror of the war. Few outsiders wished to hear about it. In the post-war 1950s, neither genocide survivors nor the medical profession knew much about the physiological or psychological aftereffects of massive psychic trauma. The term PTSD had not yet been coined. Trauma studies were not yet a discipline. Neuroscience was in its infancy. The Cold War followed on the heels of the Second World War, and in many countries, the murder of Jews all but disappeared from public discourse. Anti-Semites questioned whether the Holocaust had even occurred. Throughout the world, children of Holocaust survivors were encouraged by their teachers and their own parents to blend into their local communities. I grew up on the multicultural but largely Jewish Upper West Side of Manhattan and attended school with children of domestic and international refugees, blacklisted American communists, and Chinese and Latin American political refugees, none of whom advertised their traumatic family histories. At a sixth grade reunion, years later, some of my former classmates recalled the Auschwitz tattoo on my mother's forearm and being told by their parents not to stare or ask any questions. I lived in two cultures. At home, my refugee parents and their friends spoke freely about their wartime experiences. But at school and in the culture at large, the Second World War was almost exclusively about American military prowess. In the 1960s, a popular television sitcom, Hogan's Heroes, portrayed Nazis as clueless and incompetent. The gap between domestic and public discussion of the war persisted until my college years. In other parts of the world, especially communist-dominated Europe, it existed for much longer. Since there was so little public dialogue, I didn't know other members of the second generation in New York were thinking about the same issues I was. I did not meet Toby Mostiser, David Soni, Anita Norick, and Lucie Steinitz, who published an anthology of essays about the second generation in 1975. Or Art Spiegelman, who began interviewing his father at that time and drawing what would become the brilliant graphic novel, Mouse. Second-generation artists and writers Eva Hoffman and Bernice Eisenstein in Canada, Anne Karp and Lisa Opinionese in the United Kingdom, the late Neva Semmel, Ari Folman, and Savion Liebrecht in Israel, Irena Klepfisch, Lev Raphael, Sonia Pilzer, Melvin Jules Bukiet, Elizabeth Rossner and Thane Rosenbaum in the United States. And Henrik Broder and Aliana Brodmann in Germany developed their thinking about the legacy of the Holocaust separately. Like many Jews, I was deeply influenced by the African-American civil rights movement of the 1950s, which I understood was as much about self-definition as attaining legal equality in the United States. But it was not until I was a student at Hebrew University in 1967 that I understood for the first time what it taught me about myself. In Jerusalem, I identified what I called a peer group without a sign. Many of my friends there were trilingual, speaking the language of their birthplace, the language of their parents' country, then Hebrew or Yiddish. Jorge from Sao Paulo, for example, spoke Hungarian as well as Portuguese and English. Sammy Schlingerbaum from Brussels spoke French, Yiddish, and Polish. Some of my peers had been born in displaced persons camps. Their parents had been resistance fighters, or concentration camp or labor camp inmates. Or they had hidden for years in attics or holes in the ground, or lived in the open with false papers. All had felt the presence of what they called the war. Our conversations laid the early foundations for this book. After I returned to New York in 1970 and became a journalist, I wrote a semi-autobiographical novel titled We Who Came After the War. It was rejected by several publishers, but I managed to publish a few articles about my peer group without a sign in small Jewish magazines, and in 1977 in the mass circulation New York Times magazine. I ended that piece with the words, "I suspect this article is only the beginning of a long conversation," and received hundreds of detailed responses, invitations to conferences at libraries, universities, and religious institutions, an extraordinary set of resources for a researcher. I was also offered a book contract. I turned away from third-person journalism and wrote Children of the Holocaust, the first of what would become a trilogy of first-person nonfiction books about my survivor family. I structured it like a loaf of challah or Sabbath bread. The three braids, as I conceived them, were first my own family story. Second, the narratives of other sons and daughters of survivors, selected to reflect the spectrum of survivor families. And third, a summary of the small body of academic research of that time. The concept of intergenerational transmission of trauma was new, and I felt it necessary to contextualize my own story with others. Like many memoirs that strike a collective chord, Children of the Holocaust served as a validating and normalizing text for thousands of sons and daughters of Holocaust survivors. I have been told that it served a similar function for children of non-Jewish survivors of Nazism, children of other genocide survivors, children of families traumatized by war, loss and abuse, and children of alcoholics. The book was adopted as a college text in various fields. In addition to thinking of it as a pioneering work of journalism, I like to think of it as a contribution to what Jews call tikkun olam, or repair of the world. Hundreds of books, plays, films, pieces of music, and art by gifted members of the second generation followed, as well as doctoral dissertations and papers on scientific research into the psychological and physiological sequelae of trauma. In writing Children of the Holocaust, I learned that the narrative of genocide often obscured and sometimes replaced family history. That, and my parents' early deaths, led me to write Where She Came From, A Daughter's Search for Her Mother's History, a book that reconstructs the lives of my grandmother and other Central European Jewish dressmakers. Surviving genocide often disrupts traditional roles in survivor families, as well as parenting styles and expectations of love, friendship, and sexuality. My growing awareness of this disruption in my own family led me to write The Long Half-Lives of Love and Trauma, a book that examines my parents' marriage and my own sexualized childhood. Children of the Holocaust has been published.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.